Dover 1 by Joyce Porter, narrated by Sam Devereaux. Chapter 1. It was spring. The windows of the chain stores bloomed with plastic daffodils, and the first buds were beginning to burgeon through layers of London's soot. The assistant commissioner, C, took a deep breath and smiled happily as he detected a vernal whiff in the mingled petrol and diesel fumes. With reckless abandon, he celebrated the rebirth of the year by purchasing a 1-6 pink carnation for his buttonhole. The bloom had been forced in a continental hothouse, and glistened not with dew, but with a mouthful of tap water which had just been spat upon it by the flower seller. But for the assistant commissioner, it symbolized being in England, now that April was there. He strode jauntily along to his office in New Scotland Yard, casting roguish glances at the legs of such young ladies as he happened to meet. By 4 o'clock in the afternoon, both the pink carnation and the assistant commissioner were looking their age. The assistant commissioner had spent most of the day on one of those futile committees which bedevil the lives of our top administrators. After 5 hours of acrimonious bickering, he had been defeated over a matter of such staggering insignificance that both sides had rapidly discarded not only common sense but even expediency, and based their arguments on matters of principle. And in matters of principle, as well as in everything else, the assistant commissioner liked to get his own way. He was still resentfully chewing over his defeat when, just after 4 o'clock, his phone rang. He snatched the receiver up.
"Well?"
he snarled. His secretary was unperturbed.
"The Chief Constable of Creedshire on the line for you, sir," she said calmly. "Mr. Bartlett."
"Hello, Bartlett,"
roared the Assistant Commissioner, who always shouted on the telephone.
"You're in the chair now, I take it?"
"Yes, I am." Mr. Bartlett's voice came tinnily over the wires. "I took over yesterday."
"Must be a very nice little job,"
bellowed the Assistant Commissioner.
"Down there in the country at this time of year? Wouldn't mind changing places with you myself, I must say."
"Yes, it's very..."
"Not too much work either, I'll bet. Bit of sheep stealing and failing to notify foot and mouth, and that's your lot, eh?"
"Well, not quite. That's what I wanted to..."
"I used to tell old George Turner he'd got the cushiest job in the country. God only knows he won't have any problems adjusting to retirement. He hasn't done a stroke in the last 15 years, to my certain knowledge."
The assistant commissioner chuckled ruefully and prepared to launch into a well-oiled dissertation on his own unfair burden of cares and responsibilities. Mr. Bartlett cut the small talk short. "I need your help," he said flatly.
"Oh?"
said the assistant commissioner.
"What's the matter?"
"A young woman's disappeared."
"How long?"
"Her employer, she works as a kind of maid, hasn't seen her since Tuesday lunchtime."
"But damn it, man, it's only Thursday now,"
protested the assistant commissioner.
"You don't want to start getting into a muck sweat yet. She's probably only hopped off for a few days with her boyfriend."
"There's no indication at all that she intended to go away. Rather the reverse." The chief constable sounded petulant. He had not expected an argument. His objections were grandly pushed aside.
"My dear chap,"
said the assistant commissioner, only too obviously trying to be kind and helpful to the new boy.
"Girls are like that, especially servant girls. Some bright young spark catches their eye and it's up with their skirts, hot foot to the nearest haystack, figuratively speaking, of course. Happens in a flash, you know, spring and all that."
"Well, you may be right," began Bartlett.
"Of course I'm right."
Even 200 miles away, the interruption rang with self-satisfaction. "But I don't think you are," Burton pressed on while he had the chance. "I've got a feeling there's something fishy about this case, and I'm not going to take any chances. Better be safe than sorry, that's my motto. I don't want to be caught like old George Turner was."
"Why? What happened to him?"
The assistant commissioner was a great one for a bit of police gossip. "In all the 20 years he sat in this chair before me, they only had one murder in the county. Woman battered to death with an axe, blood and brains all over the kitchen floor, you know the sort of thing. Well, George turned the local boys loose on it, and you've never seen such a cock-up in all your life. They ended up by arresting the vicar's son on such rubbishy evidence that the public prosecutor wouldn't even let him bring the case before the magistrates. All the yokels were laughing themselves silly because everybody knew who'd done it except the poor old cops. The chap got off scot-free and poor old George Turner never lived it down. They never let him forget it, I can tell you. Well, they're not going to get me tied hand and foot like that."
"No, no, of course not.
the assistant commissioner chimed in with evident sympathy.
Watch committees can be devils, I couldn't agree more. You've got to be top dog or they'll lead you a dog's life.
There was a pause while both men pondered over the infelicity of this metaphor.
Well, you see, don't you?
Mr. Bartlett went on. If my sixth sense is right, and this girl hasn't just slipped off for a bit of slap and tickle with somebody else's husband, it might be a very nasty case. Very nasty indeed.
Murder, you mean?
Or kidnapping?
Kidnapping? Now, steady on, old man. You've been seeing too much telly. We don't have kidnapping in this country. Place is much too small. Besides, it's not English.
There's always a first time, said Mr. Bartlett darkly. And it'd just be my bloody luck to get clobbered with it.
Well, what have you done so far?
The local bobby scratched around a bit. Like everybody else, he thought she'd be turning up again right as rain. Bar reporting it to HQ, I don't think he's done much. There's an outbreak of foul pest or swine fever or something, and naturally that's far more up his street than one of these vanishing lady larks.
I suppose you've circulated the usual description?
Yes, we did that right away.
Not that it helps much. One young girl looks pretty much like another these days.
Not this one. She stands 5'3" in stiletto heels, and she turns the scales at nearly 16 stone.
My God!
Said the assistant commissioner, duly impressed at last. And she's got bright ginger hair. It makes a difference, doesn't it?
It does indeed, old man.
Yes, dead or alive, she's going to be difficult to hide. Now do you see why I want some help? 16 stone of bouncing British girlhood can't just disappear into thin air, can it?
No, indeed it can't, old chap. Once seen, never forgotten by the sound of it.
Yes, I'm inclined to agree with you. You should have got a line by now if she's still kicking around.
Then can you let me have somebody right away? Somebody good, mind. I don't want one of your old deadbeats.
There are no deadbeats on my staff, old man.
The assistant commissioner spoke with heavy reproof, but the expression had given him an idea. He still wasn't convinced that this was a case for the yard, but he didn't want to turn down a chap who was understandably being a bit wary in his new job. And anyhow, Bartlett might just conceivably turn out to be right. Murder would be bad enough, but kidnapping, from the professional point of view, could be terrible. At least in the case of murder, you couldn't blame the dead body on the police. But in kidnapping, whatever you did might be wrong. If you let them hand over the ransom money, the kidnappers might still kill their victim. And if you stopped the ransom money, you were equally likely to be left with a corpse on your hands. The assistant commissioner shuddered gently as he thought of all the messes you could get into in a kidnapping case. It wasn't the sort of job you'd wish on a dog. He turned back to the telephone. There was only one man for the job.
I'll send you one of my chief inspectors, he said. Good chap. Name's Dover. I'll get him down to you first thing in the morning.
The assistant commissioner dropped the receiver back in place and grinned wickedly. A man in his exalted position shouldn't indulge in petty spite where his subordinates were concerned. But it was oh so pleasant to give way to these little human frailties once in a while.
I'd love to see the old bugger's face when he hears what he's got himself landed with this time.
The assistant commissioner chuckled happily to himself and picked up his phone again to send the good news down the line.
Bloody waste of time,
snarled Chief Inspector Wilfred Dover, as he sat slumped and sulky in the corner of his first-class reserved compartment. His sergeant, sitting opposite him, sighed with resignation. He'd had nearly 4 hours of this, and whatever sympathy he'd had at the beginning had now worn very thin.
Yes, sir,
he said, and gazed hopelessly out of the window.
I don't know why it is,
Dover grumbled remorselessly on.
It always seems to be me that gets landed with these jobs.
You'll see. We'll hang around there for a couple of days and then she'll turn up again, older and wiser, if you know what I mean.
Hold up in Brighton, that's where she is. And when her money runs out, the boyfriend'll hop it and she'll come back home.
Dover snorted petulantly down his nose.
What'd I say her name was?
He growled. Sergeant MacGregor told him wearily, and for the fourth time.
Rugg, sir. Juliet Rugg.
Dover paused to give his little joke an appropriate build-up.
Well, I reckon Juliet's found her Romeo.
Sergeant MacGregor smiled bleakly. He'd heard this 4 times before, too. Charles Edward MacGregor was, in fact, feeling nearly as hard done by as Dover was, though for a slightly different reason. He regarded himself, and was indeed regarded by his superiors, as one of the up-and-coming young officers at the Yard. He was intelligent, efficient, courteous and sympathetic, and extremely well-dressed to boot. It seemed unfair that he should be coupled with Chief Inspector Dover, who was his exact opposite in almost everything. But the Assistant Commissioner, who kept a fatherly eye on these matters, was a great believer in baptisms of fire and salvation through suffering, and he frequently used Dover to provide both for young detectives whose opinion of themselves was, perhaps, a little too high. The Assistant Commissioner felt, with some justification, that if a lad could stick Dover, he could stick almost anything. It was damned good character training. He had, therefore, turned a deaf ear to the pleas of both Dover and Sergeant McGregor that the first case upon which they had been engaged together should be their last. Inspector Dover in the spilt milk. This case has not, and will not, be published at any price. And so here they were again, already chafing in their double harness and setting out with sinking hearts and mutual ill will to solve the apparently unmysterious disappearance of Juliet Rugg. A police car was waiting for them at Creedon Station. The police driver saluted smartly, opened the door, packed their cases in the boot, and leapt athletically into his seat. He was alert and keen. 10 minutes later, at the end of their journey, he was wondering if his brother-in-law's offer of a job in the slaughterhouse was still open. Chief Inspector Dover was a nervous passenger, and he didn't care who knew it. A non-driver himself, he was nonetheless acutely sensitive to the hazards which beset the man at the wheel. Crouching tensely on the back seat, he shared all his premonitions of impending danger with the unfortunate man who was actually driving the car. The endless stream of advice to look out for dogs, old ladies, young children, pedestrian crossings, traffic lights, bicycles, learner drivers, blind corners, and one-way streets was relieved only by pungent post-mortems on previous risky maneuvers, which had already brought the three of them within kissing distance of the jaws of death. By the grace of God, and in spite of Dover, the police driver, a man of 14 years' unblemished experience, got the car safely to the headquarters of the Creedshire Constabulary. Dover heaved himself out of the back and lumbered off into the building without a word. McGregor did the honours on his behalf. "Thank you very much, driver," he said with a winning smile. The driver just looked at him, not trusting himself to speak, and turned away with trembling hands to unload the baggage. Inside the police headquarters, Dover was ushered rapidly into the presence of the chief constable. Mr. Bartlett had prepared and practiced a little speech of welcome, brief but covering rather neatly, he thought, all the essential points. When the two detectives were announced, he glanced up distractedly from his desk. This had been rehearsed too. He was about to flash a frank, manly smile at them when his first actual sight of Dover literally took his breath away. The chief inspector, purple in the face, and with his bowler hat rammed well down over his ears, came into the room like a charging rhinoceros.
"That bloody driver of yours isn't fit to drive a toy scooter on a fairground roundabout," he roared.
The chief constable's jaw dropped. Was this what the assistant commissioner had sent him? He gazed in helpless fascination at the figure which loomed, snorting furiously above his desk. Detective Chief Inspector Wilfred Dover was a big man. His 6'2" frame was draped, none too elegantly, in 17 1/4 stone of flabby flesh, an excessive proportion of which had settled round his middle. Well-cut clothing can, of course, do wonders to conceal such natural defects as the spread of middle age, but Dover bought his suits ready-made, and the one he was wearing at the moment had been purchased a long time ago. It was made of shiny blue serge. Round his thick policeman's neck, he wore a blue-striped collar, which was almost submerged in the folds of fat, and a thin, cheap tie was knotted under the lowest of his double chins. He wore a long, dark blue overcoat and stout black boots. Over the whole of this unprepossessing ensemble, there was, naturally enough, Dover's face. It was large and flabby like the rest of him. Only the details, nose, mouth, and eyes, seemed out of scale. They were so tiny as to be almost lost in the wide expanse of flesh. Dover had two small, mean, button-like eyes, a snub little nose, and a sulky rosebud of a mouth. He looked like one of those pastry men that children make on baking day out of odd scraps, with currants for eyes. An uncooked pastry man, of course. His hair was thin and black, and he had a small black moustache of the type that the late Adolf Hitler did so much to depopularize. Mr. Bartlett gulped and pulled himself together. "Chief Inspector Dover?" he asked in the faint hope that it might be somebody else.
Yes.
The hope died.
And this is Sergeant McGregor.
Well, I'm very pleased to meet you both. Dover grunted derisively. I just wanted to see you, Dover, to assure you that we'll try and, give you every assistance we can. Naturally, we all want to get this business cleared up as soon as possible.
Too right we do,
said Dover bluntly and stared sneeringly round the room. Yes. Well, I've rearranged for my CID inspector to brief you, and then I expect you'll be wanting to get off and have a look at the scene of the crime, eh?
What crime?
Demanded Dover.
Don't tell me you've actually found the body now.
No, no, she's still missing. I just mean where she lived and where she was last seen and everything. The chief constable had had more than enough of this and was already ringing the bell for his inspector. Unlike Mr. Bartlett, the local CID inspector hadn't bothered to prepare anything. He rummaged dejectedly among the mountain of files and odd sheets of loose paper which covered his desk. Judy Rudd, he muttered, his attention momentarily caught by the sight of his football coupon. He put it carefully on one side and scrabbled around a bit more until he found the accompanying envelope. Judy Rudd, he murmured again. I've got the file on her somewhere. Sergeant McGregor cleared his throat.
I think the name is Rugg, sir, he proffered. Juliet Rugg. With a G.
The local man looked surprised.
Juliet Rugg with a G?
He asked doubtfully.
Are you sure?
Dover couldn't stand it any longer. With a snort of seething impatience, he strode to the desk, pushed aside three library books and a packet of sandwiches, picked up a file, glanced at the heading, and slapped it down without a word in front of the inspector.
Oh, said the inspector. Oh, yes, thank you. Well now, Juliet Rugg, that's the one you've come about, isn't it? Yes, well, there's not much I can tell you about her case, I'm afraid.
He peered at the file.
Oh, yes, she was reported missing by Miss Eve Counter of Earlham Old Hall on Wednesday afternoon. That's the day before yesterday, of course. Missing girl is called Juliet Rugg, age 18, working as a maid in the employ of Sir John Counter, also of Earlham Old Hall.
He glanced up at his visitors.
Perhaps I should explain about Earlham Old Hall, he suggested unenthusiastically. It's a bit involved. It's one of these old houses about a couple of miles outside the village of Earlham. Some time ago, before the war, I think the family couldn't keep the place up any longer, so they converted the house into flats. They sold off most of the land and they built half a dozen houses on the bit that was left. Three on either side of the drive, actually. Then they did up the two small lodges by the main gates. So Earlham Old Hall these days is a kind of little housing estate, if you see what I mean. Of course, it's quite an expensive setup. Even the flats are about £4 or £5 a week. Unfurnished, of course, but they don't use numbers or names. Everybody puts Earlham Old Hall on their notepaper and the postman just has to sort out which house or flat to deliver it to by the name of the occupier. The present owner, Mrs. Chubb Smith, she lives in one of the lodges now. She's had several rows with the post office about it, but so far she's had her own way. So this gentleman who employs Juliet Rugg, Sir John Counter, he and his daughter live in one of the houses built in the grounds.
I see,
said Dover and sniffed.
Well now, where was I? Oh yes, Juliet Rugg left the Counter's house after lunch on Tuesday afternoon. It was her afternoon off, and they expected her back as usual about 11 o'clock that night. Well, she didn't turn up, of course. Well, the village constable went along to see the girl's mother. She lives in the village, and ascertained that the girl had called in to see her mother for about an hour on Tuesday afternoon. She didn't say anything about going away, and she left to catch the 3:15 bus into Creedon here to have a look around the shops and what have you. That was quite normal, and she did it every week. The local chap, ascertained that she caught the bus all right. Well, at this stage in the inquiry, our chap heard that Mr. Bartlett was going to call the yard in, so he didn't pursue his inquiries any further, and that's really just about all there is.
We booked a couple of rooms for you in the pub at Earlham.
It's not much of a place, but we thought you'd like to be on the spot. Oh, and we've got a car for you. You won't want a driver, will you? The file's got all the addresses in it, and there's a sketch plan of Earlham Old Hall with the names of the people living there. I don't think there's anything else you'll want at the moment, is there?
The inspector glanced anxiously at his football pools.
No, said Dover and rammed his bowler hat on his head. Come on, Sergeant, we'd better get moving. We'll obviously have to start from the beginning again, so we'll go and see this counterwoman first.
Sergeant McGregor accepted the file from the limp hand of the inspector, thanked him for his help, and dashed off after his superior officer.
He had a feeling that this case was going to be even worse than their first one was. Chapter 2. They found Earlhamold Hall quite easily, and Sergeant McGregor braked gently from the cautious 30 miles an hour which was all Dover would permit, glanced in his rear mirror, changed down to third, flicked out his right trafficator, poked out his right arm to its full extent, glanced in his mirror again, and with bated breath carefully turned the car across a completely deserted, dead-straight country road, and eased his way sedately through the entrance gates. The two men gazed thoughtfully through the windscreen. Before them lay a wide, graveled drive which had long ago lost its struggle with the encroaching grass and weeds. The drive ran in a series of sweeping curves which seemed to have no functional value as the ground was perfectly flat, up to a front of a large 18th-century building whose architecture was pleasing rather than distinguished. On either side of the main drive were the new houses of which the local CID inspector had spoken. They stood well back, and each was separated from its neighbours by a reasonably large garden and thick clusters of trees. Four smaller paths led off from the main sweep of the drive. On either side of the main gate were two tiny ivy-encrusted lodges. Mrs. Chubb Smith, the present owner of the property, lived, according to the sketch plan, in the one on the left. Sergeant McGregor guided the shiny black police car up the drive at a docile 15 miles an hour.
"Which one is the counter's house?"
asked Dover. "It's the top one on the left, sir. Must be that big one over there."
"Hmm,"
said Dover, frowning crossly at the well-kept flower beds and trim lawns.
"Sir John, or whatever his name is, doesn't look short of the ready, anyhow."
The door was opened by a dark-haired, solemn-faced woman in her middle 30s. She looked anxiously at her visitors. Dover flicked the brim of his bowler hat with the index finger of his right hand.
"Good morning. Is Miss Eve Counter in? We'd like to have a word with her."
"I'm Eve Counter."
The voice was low and pleasant, but lacking in assurance.
"Are you the detectives?"
"Yes, miss. I'm Chief Inspector Dover, and this is Detective Sergeant McGregor. We've come down from Scotland Yard."
"Well, I think you better come inside, then."
She led them into a large, airy drawing room decorated in a restful pastel green. Dover and McGregor sank into the depths of a couple of huge armchairs, while Miss Counter perched herself on an upright chair placed in front of a writing desk. Just as Dover was about to begin, she shot off her seat and grabbed a cigarette box from a small table.
"Will you have a cigarette?"
she asked, thrusting the box at them. Dover accepted, as he always did, but Sergeant McGregor refused. There was an embarrassing little moment when the table lighter wouldn't work, and McGregor produced his, an elegant gold one, to the accompaniment of a shower of thanks and apologies from Miss Counter, who blushed slightly as she accepted a light from the tall, handsome sergeant. Everything settled down again, and Dover opened his mouth for the second time. When Miss Counter realized with another nervous start that there were no ashtrays, once again she rushed round the room apologizing for her forgetfulness. Dover sighed.
"Well now, Miss Counter," he said at long last, "I understand that you reported the disappearance of Miss Rugg to the police."
"Yes, that's right, I did. My father said I was making a lot of unnecessary fuss and that she'd turn up again, but when she hadn't come back at lunchtime on Wednesday, I thought I'd better ring the police. It couldn't do any harm, could it?"
"When did you last see her?"
"Just after lunch on Tuesday. It was her afternoon off, and she usually used to get back about 11. I'd gone to bed earlier, and when I came down in the morning, I found that the front door was still unlocked. Then I went into the kitchen, and I saw that Juliet hadn't made herself a hot drink when she came in, as she usually did. I thought it was a bit odd, but I got breakfast and took it in to my father. I asked him if Juliet had looked in last night to say goodnight to him, and he said no, she hadn't. Well, I got on with my work, but about 11 o'clock I thought I'd just pop up and see if she was all right. I went up to her room, but she wasn't there, and the bed hadn't been slept in."
"Was anything missing from her room? A suitcase, a change of clothing?"
"No, not as far as I could see. Everything seemed to be there."
"I understand, Miss Counter," said Dover, "that Miss Rugg was employed here as a maid. Wasn't she supposed to get up and get the breakfast and do the housework?"
Miss Counter stubbed her cigarette out in the ashtray and automatically took another out of the box. Sergeant McGregor proffered his lighter once again, and Miss Counter inhaled a deep pull of smoke into her lungs. She murmured her thanks, and Dover waited patiently for an answer to his question.
Juliet wasn't exactly employed here as a housemaid, Inspector, she said, speaking rather quickly. She's really kind of a companion to my father. He's more or less confined to the house now, although he's not bedridden by any means. He likes to have somebody to chat to and to fetch things for him and so on. He likes somebody fresh and young around him, and that was Juliet's job, generally to just keep him amused. Usually we have a cook and a housemaid as well, but you know what it's like trying to get servants these days, even foreign ones. At the moment we haven't got anybody except a char who comes in to do the rough work a couple of days a week.
She gave a wry little laugh.
While Juliet looks after my father, I have to turn and look after the house.
What time did you expect to see Miss Rugg then on the Wednesday morning?
Well, she usually spent every morning in bed, so not much before midday, really. You see, my father stops in bed until lunchtime, so there's nothing much for Juliet to do. He doesn't normally get to bed until around midnight. He always watches the television until it closes down, so she's kept up pretty late at night. If it hadn't been for the unlocked door and no dirty cups and things in the kitchen, I shouldn't have even thought of looking for her till about 12:30 the next day.
Do you know what she usually did on her afternoon off?
No. I never asked her and she never told me.
Dover gazed moodily at Miss Counter, as though he were trying to picture her with a hempen rope around her neck.
How much was Miss Rugg paid as a companion to your father?
Eve Counter frowned.
£10 a week, she said shortly.
All found?
All found.
There was a pause while the Chief Inspector pondered over this interesting bit of information. He slumped back even deeper into his chair, his beady little eyes fixed unblinkingly on his hostess's face.
Do you like Miss Rugg, madam?
He asked in a mild conversational voice. Eve Counter jumped slightly, then her chin went up.
No, Chief Inspector, I don't. Not much, anyhow.
Dover accepted the implied challenge in her answer.
Care to tell me why, madam?
Well, we had absolutely nothing in common. I'm very much older than she is, and, well, I come from a different class of society. I have a completely different background. I don't want you to think I'm a snob, but her manners and her behaviour, well, I found them quite intolerable. For me, she just symbolised all that is so dreadful about young people today. Phony American accents, layers of makeup which are never washed off, cheap scent, nails thick with grime and looking as though they've been dipped in blood. Ugh, I thought she was quite revolting.
Eve Counter seemed to be getting quite excited.
Of course she looked quite awful too. She was so fat that it was frankly unbelievable. And that terrible frizzy ginger hair, when it wasn't blonde, that is. To see her mincing along in those high-heeled shoes, well, really. And of course, she thought she was quite the femme fatale. She was always boasting about all the boyfriends she had and hinting at the number of affairs she'd had with men. And at 18, too.
Anything else?
Asked Dover. Miss Counter shook her head, as though annoyed with herself.
She was always poking into things that didn't concern her, she said gruffly. Reading other people's letters and things like that. Of course, it wasn't anything serious. It was just irritating to have a girl like that in the house.
Then why did you, Miss Counter?
Miss Counter looked bewildered.
Why did I what, Inspector?
Why did you employ Miss Rugg?
She took a deep breath.
I didn't, Inspector. I told you. She's employed by my father.
Dover eased his weight pensively from one buttock to the other.
In that case, I think we'd better have a word with Sir John, he said heavily.
Oh, well, could you leave it till after lunch, Inspector?
Like most women when they are asking a favour, however small, from a man, Eve Counter smiled. The effect was devastating. Sergeant MacGregor's eyes opened wide in astonishment, and even Dover, not hypersensitive to feminine charm, blinked. In repose, Eve Counter's thin face had a faintly petulant, disappointed look about it. Her mouth drooped at the corners, and her forehead seemed permanently creased in a little cross frown. But when she smiled, her whole face was transformed. Her lips seemed full and red, and parted delightfully over small white teeth, and her eyes, now suddenly dark and handsome, sparkled in a most bewitching manner. The lank, unkempt dark hair, the dowdy, useful frock she wore with such careless inelegance, the too thin body which it covered, all this was forgotten when she smiled. Then, she suddenly became a woman of quite exceptional charm and attraction, a woman with whom a man might easily fall in love. She seemed totally unaware of the effect she was having on the two policemen.
You see, he's rather an old man now, and he's got to harbour his strength. It's very tiring for him if his routine gets broken. I'd really rather not wake him up now, if you don't mind.
No, that's all right, madam,
said Dover, still rather disconcerted by the sheer beauty which had broken so unexpectedly through the habitually discontented set of Eve Counter's face.
We've got to go and see the girl's mother in the village, so it'll be quite convenient for us to come back here after lunch. Perhaps we could have a look at Miss Rugg's room at the same time?
Of course, Inspector.
The smile glowed briefly into life again.
And as I've told you, I don't really like Juliet, but I don't wish her any harm, naturally. I suppose you haven't found out anything yet?
We've only just come on the case, Miss Counter, said Dover. It's a bit early in the day yet for jumping to conclusions. My own personal guess is that the girl's hiding out somewhere with some man or other. That's usually what happens in these cases. I don't doubt she'll turn up safe and sound in a day or two. However,
Dover realized that he was perhaps being a bit too offhand about the whole thing.
We shall pursue our inquiries in the usual way. We're very grateful to you for your help. Good morning, madam.
Well, said MacGregor as he switched on the ignition, that girl ought to smile more often. You'd never have thought it, would you? I wouldn't have given her a second look, but hell, when she smiled, she really got something. Mind you, he added judicially, her legs weren't bad either.
I'm sure your expert knowledge of the female sex is going to be invaluable, Sergeant, said Dover with heavy sarcasm. But perhaps, just for now, you could concentrate on your driving.
Dover looked around as they proceeded slowly down the drive.
Who lives in the other lodge?
He demanded. Sergeant MacGregor thought rapidly.
Colonel Bing and a Miss McClintock.
He dug the names triumphantly out of his excellent memory. I suppose she's his housekeeper. Dover blew disapprovingly down his nose.
Well, we all know what that means,
he commented unfairly.
Anyhow, there's a woman standing there at the front door with a dog in her arms. Must be Miss What's-Her-Name. Hey, hold on a minute, Sergeant. She's waving us to stop.
As the police car dribbled to a halt, the woman, still clutching the dog, a small white poodle, to her bosom, came up to the window on Dover's side. The chief inspector wound the glass down. The woman and the dog peered in.
Are you the chaps from Scotland Yard?
She asked in a deep, excited voice.
We are, madam, responded Dover. And you, I take it, are Miss...
He nudged Sergeant MacGregor violently for his cue.
Miss McClintock?
The woman grinned broadly.
Oh, no, I'm not.
She chuckled, obviously enjoying her little triumph.
I'm Colonel Bing.
Oh,
said Dover. There didn't seem anything else to say. He blazed a look of fury at poor Sergeant MacGregor.
Look, Colonel Bing went on, if you chaps can spare a couple of shakes, I've got a bit of information which I think you ought to have. I haven't said anything to the cops up to now because, frankly, I didn't take this absence without leave caper very seriously. Georgie always tells me I'm forever poking my nose in, so this time I said to myself, bingo, this time you're just going to mind your own bloody business. But when we heard last night that they were bringing the big guns up, Georgie agreed with me that I ought to tell you about it and not leave you to go scratching around on your own and getting nowhere.
And who?
Demanded Dover as he heaved himself resignedly out of the car.
Who is Georgie?
Colonel Bing's shout of delighted laughter echoed loudly round the countryside.
You're a witty old devil, she bellowed. Why, Georgie's Miss McClintock.
Struth,
muttered Dover sourly and clumped heavily after her into the little lodge. Inside the house, which was really remarkably small and unbelievably cluttered up with bits and pieces of furniture, Colonel Bing seemed to grow in stature. Her voice, which had been loud outdoors, now battered unpleasantly on the eardrums. In reality, she was only of medium height and had a no more than well-covered matronly figure befitting her maturing years. Her hair was iron grey and cropped quite short. She was wearing a drab green woolly twinset and a pleated tartan skirt. On her legs, she had a pair of sensible ribbed lisle stockings, and her feet were shod in a pair of highly polished brogues, which looked stout enough to kick the heart out of a Highlander.
Come along, you chaps, she rallied them. Squat yourselves down and take a load off your minds.
Dover, lumbering clumsily across the threshold of the sitting room, stumbled slightly as he caught his foot in a small rug. He lurched forward, his hand automatically stretched out to help regain his balance, just as Colonel Bing bent down to release the poodle. Dover saw the straining expanse of Hunting Stewart, but not in time.
Colonel Bing straightened up smartly and cut through the chief inspector's muttered apologies.
Just watch it, old chap,
she warned him grimly.
Just watch it.
Dover backed nervously away as far as he could, which was no more than 3 inches, and collapsed heavily into a chair. Colonel Bing, keeping a wary eye on Dover in case his bestial instincts got the better of him again, sat down too, and this left just enough room for Sergeant McGregor to squeeze in. With his knees almost touching those of Colonel Bing, he managed to drag out his notebook and pencil and waited, hardly daring to breathe, for the revelations to begin.
Right, said Colonel Bing. Everybody settled? Well, I'll kick off, shall I? Now, as I understand it, this is as far as you chaps have got. You know Juliet Rugg left Counter's house after lunch on Tuesday and then went down to the village to see her mother, right? And then you know she caught the 3:15 bus into Creedon, right? But after that, it's a complete blank.
I wouldn't say that,
objected Dover in a half-hearted attempt to regain control of the situation.
We've barely started our investigations.
My source of intelligence, Colonel Bing crushed him without mercy, is Police Constable Robson, on whose report your briefing was based this morning. The police, so far, have not traced that girl's movements after the bus dropped her in Creedon.
Colonel Bing's emphatic statement of the facts brooked no argument, and Dover didn't attempt any.
All right,
he said sulkily.
I suppose you saw her later than that?
Indeed I did. Very much later. I saw her just before 11 o'clock on the Tuesday night.
Dover sat up slightly.
You did you? Where was this?
I'm telling this in my own way,
said Colonel Bing flatly. She nodded to Sergeant McGregor.
You take this down, young man, and stop me if I go too fast for you, right? Well, Georgie, that's Miss McClintock, MC, INTOCK, got it? Georgie and I went across on Tuesday evening to play bridge with the Freels. FREELS. They're a brother and sister, Amy and Basil. You can spell those all right, can you? A brother and sister who live in the first house next to the lodge opposite. We arrived at about 7:30 and got back here at 9:45 or maybe 10:50. Now, I'd had to leave the hellhound here by himself because the Freels have got a cat, and naturally the poor brute wanted a breath of fresh air and a walk around the garden before heading for the pit. Georgie went in to make the cocoa, and I stood outside with Peregrine, that's the dog, while he had a sniff around. He's rather a highly strung beast, and he doesn't like being out by himself after dark. Well, we were both outside there in the garden. A car drew up at the entrance gates. They're closed at nights, you know, because we've had a lot of trouble with courting couples diving in to do their snogging off the main road. Damn disgusting. But you know what they're like these days? Well, naturally, having nothing else to look at, really, I moved across the hedge and had a squint in the car. After a minute or two, the passenger door opened and this girl, Juliet Rugg, got out. I expect you've had a description of her, so you'll know she was a pretty unmistakable figure. Disgustingly overweight for a girl of her age, but far too lazy and stupid to do anything about it. Anyhow, I could see quite clearly...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.